I'd like to welcome to the stage the next generation of artistic voices in our field, beginning with our first team, led by stage director Noam Shapiro, as they present The Little Prince. This team reimagines The Little Prince as a modern migration story. As a group of migrants wait at the US border, a father calms the children by recasting their dangerous journey as the intergalactic travels of the Little Prince, transforming their interactions with smugglers, officers, and aid workers into encounters with strange grownups and resplendent beasts in a world without borders. Please welcome the artistic team for The Little Prince.
Thank you, Stephanie, for the introduction. I also want to thank Laura Lee, Claire, Gina, and everyone at Opera America for giving us and all the teams this incredible opportunity to share our visions for these reimagined productions with you today. We'd specifically also like to thank our mentor, Alan Moyer, who was instrumental in helping us execute this vision, as well as Julia DeSenza and Kelvin Potter, who helped us execute it as well. Just to introduce myself again, I'm Noam Shapiro, and I'm the director of the production.
I'm Aide, and I'm the costume designer.
And I'm Santiago, I'm a scenic designer.
And also on our team are Tamrin Goldberg, our choreographer, Reza Behjat, our lighting designer, and Yana Birÿkova, our projection designer. As a team of international artists with immigrant backgrounds and stories of our own, we were drawn to The Little Prince's story of a young child who leaves his home and courageously and curiously explores the world, looking for a safe new planet. And that led us to ask who a little prince might be today, which led us to imagine a production of The Little Prince as a modern migration story. We also decided to model our production after the Public Theater in New York's Public Works Initiative, a production that incorporates community members into the ensemble of large-scale productions to create works of participatory theater through workshops and other masterclass opportunities so as to engage new audiences, and particularly children, in the works of opera and theater. In our production, we were inspired by the drawings of The Little Prince, but wanted to take this production in a new direction. We were especially inspired by an op-ed in the New York Times by a Salvadorian immigrant who was detained in a family detention center and spoke of how the children in that center used play and imagination to help process their experience. Our Act One begins in a modern desert in the heart of our broken immigration system in a detention center. A young boy dreams of sheep in open fields and then in cages. Suddenly he awakes in a bright lit detention center surrounded by people he doesn't know. A young father who's also making the journey begins to calm the boy by telling him the story of the little prince. As the story progresses, all of the other migrants bring their own experiences into the story, taking on the characters of the narrative.
This action takes place in a wide big room that it represent the original drawing that the pilot draw for the Little Prince, and in connection we want to represent also the kind of detention centers that we found on the border, and we kind of like make connection with those two elements.
The space begins as a raw space that then transforms over the course of the show, given the unique individual's presence in that space. Throughout the course of the show, the space operates as a space of imprisonment as well as of imagination, where the characters and the individuals in that space can momentarily transcend their circumstances.
So we have the pilot, and a big question with the pilot approaching him was who or what has the pilot lost on his journey north? And I also wanted to stay true to the classic aviator spirit. The prince, he is full of curiosity and compassion that he brings along with him throughout this entire journey. And referencing to the original Little Prince is often his golden hair. And we want to be mindful in casting, and we want to cast a young Latinx actor as the prince. And so to address the issue of the golden hair, we selected a golden hat to represent that. So the stars, the ensemble, the stars. Although we envision a primarily Latinx cast, we imagine casting children with roots in the immigrant experience from Central America, the Middle East, Asia, and Africa. And some of these are professional singers, and others are community members that are affected by immigration.
The theatrical language of the show begins in a poor theater aesthetic, with the characters using whatever is in their disposal to create the world of the prince, the pilot's plane, as well as the prince's planet. But over the course of the show, that theatrical language becomes more elaborate and imaginative. As the show progresses, lighting and projections are used to transcend the space, bringing in nature and fantasy into the world of the show. This first happens in the moment when the prince describes the sunsets on his beautiful planet and what he misses back home. A brilliant sun flashes through one of the porthole windows and then expands into a glorious landscape across the walls of the space. That then disappears as the prince talks about what he's afraid of losing in his home country as it's taken over by violent and dangerous baobabs.
So we meet the baobabs, and we meet them as members of gangs that are forcing people out of their communities and to find safety in other countries. And I use stilts to create height and tattoos all over their bodies to give the impression of bark on a tree. And then eventually, the little prince wipes away their tattoos to remind us of who these people were before they were vilified and in a sense lost.
Leaning into this fantasy element of projections, as the baobabs take over the space, projections dominate the space as well, mirroring the baobabs' tattoos and graffiti until they're wiped away by the prince as he sets up his garden for his rose.
So the rose, I was looking at many women who make the journey north, and they happen to also be young mothers. Many of them are barely out of childhood themselves. And the prince, he takes it upon himself to take care of his mother, who's described as proud and delicate, and he wants to bring her to a newer and a safer planet for her.
Again, projections are used to transform the space. This time is a memory and flashback, sending us back to the little prince's home where he spends his time with his rose. Again, a wall inspired by Mexican textiles. When the prince decides to leave his planet in order to search for a safer home, he steps off of the box, which then tracks upstage, revealing a vast desert underneath. This alludes to the network of railways and trucks that are used by Central American migrants to make their way north to the United States.
And then we meet the first of the planets, who is the king, and he is based off the Chilean dictator Augusto Pinochet. And he causes a lot of greed and corruption, thus making powerlessness among immigrants.
Each of the planets in our production is inspired by the kind of people a young migrant, especially a child, might encounter on his journey, and becomes a procession of different planets, then followed by the Vain Man, who's inspired by former Mexican President Enrique Peña Nieto, as well as street performers who make empty promises as politicians or as performers to entertain us. The drunk man steps out of the ensemble and is inspired by migrants who make the journey multiple times and are deported along the way, or even arrive here only to be sent back home. The fourth planet, the businessman, is inspired by bureaucrats both here and on the Mexican side of the border who only see individuals as numbers and not as people with unique stories. But finally, our lamplighter, who was inspired by Tomas Gonzalez Castillo, a Franciscan friar who works throughout South America to help migrants find their way, points the little prince in the right direction, planet Earth, which in our production we situate as the United States.
The lamplighter, he then summons his other volunteers, medics, and humanitarian workers from all over the world to help the boy to safety.
Many of these lamplighters are also made up of community members, so the cast is both professional singers and people who are involved in the process from outside of the opera world. At the end of the act, all of these ensemble members stream through the audience, lighting the prince's path as he makes his way to the border. As the music swells, a large fence flies in and bisects the stage.
In that moment, the fence becomes a barrier that actually represents the border wall, but also represents a cage and how we understand the people who is inside the box now is trapped. So we become the question about who is on each side of that border.
we've resituated the famous Sahara Desert from The Little Prince as the desert along the Mexican-American border. And at the beginning of Act Two, we wanted to pull in the next role of projections in this project, which is to bear witness to the human cost and to the human stories of all of these migrants, our friends, who are making their way north. And so in black, in the silence before the music begins, we watch migrants traveling on these trains, making their way northward. As the lights come up, the prince is found exploring the fence, trying to find a way through, where he encounters the snake.
The snake is based off of the Arizona Border Recon, which is made up of a group of vigilante hunters made up of vets and former law enforcement officials. Then the prince comes upon the rose garden, and they are made up of mothers, daughters, cousins, etc., all bathing and washing their laundry in the river. And this is one of the few moments where we see a lot of bright colors and patterns that help convey the sense of memory that the prince holds dear.
From the process, we see how on the Mexican border side of the fence, there is a response by like using art to reinterpret that fence and kind of like make it like disappear in the landscape. And in that way, we want to use our fence as a surface to project, use as a projection surface to have those images and those references, or like knowing like on which side of the fence we are.
As the prince continues his journey, he meets hunters who search out people such as him, including a bumbling band of new recent recruits who can't find anyone. And then the fox, who's inspired by young activists, some of them are in fact undocumented, such as Alejandro Pablos, who was here on a green card and was deported because of her activist work for immigrants. Lastly, he encounters a well, and we were inspired by groups like Water Station, which set out water stations and wells for migrants making their way through the desert. And in this case, the presence is refreshing and angelic. Scenically in lighting, we've moved from an industrial space into a natural and free world where there's perhaps even a moment of temporary transcendence. But the prince, exhausted, tired, and even homesick, returns to the fence and presents himself seeking asylum to the snake, who then takes him back in through the gates, through the fence, which then flies out. The set rolls downstage, and they pass through the door and disappear. Alone and bereft, the pilot, now in a room without any children whatsoever, implores us to pay attention and to look for the lost children and to let him know when we found them. And we hope that in this moment in the show, opera audiences that might have come for entertainment are activated to know what they must do coming out of this performance. The pilot falls asleep and dreams of a world without borders. The back wall flies out, revealing a beautiful landscape as all the characters led by the prince and the children come back and look at us. The choreography for our show is inspired by pedestrian movements, dance that can be performed by anyone, just as anyone can sing. This is a little clip of the video showcasing some of the dance for this production. We see the Rose Ballet, we'll see the Baobabs, we'll see sunsets, and we'll also see our snake.
Just my own. this asteroid contained a king on a majestic throne.
In conclusion, we just wanted to highlight one other aspect in our development process. We've been working with a lot of organizations, both arts organizations and nonprofits, that work with migrant communities to think about how audiences can be activated coming out of a production to be held responsible and to speak out against the injustices happening at our southern border as well as throughout the United States. And on our website, littleprincetheopera.com, you can see a bunch of different incredible organizations that are working through arts as well as through community service and legal aid to help address this issue, as well as steps that audience members can take at various levels of engagement to speak out and to put a stop to this injustice. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for sharing that beautiful production. And now I'd like to open it up to any questions that you might have for this team. Such rich possibility to engage your community. I think this is so important. Thank you for leading the way in that. Does anyone have any questions for this team? Maybe a question over here.
Yes, no changes were made to the libretto whatsoever. Well, Exupéry himself was an exile, and so embedded within that text, the DNA of that text, is the experience of being lost in a world that you do not recognize, and seeing the injustice of adults who do not understand the needs of children and people who are searching for a safer home.
Do we have any other questions? Yes, right here.
Well, I don't have a question. I'm just pretty moved. I'm very moved that people from the United States are presenting this conflict we have in Mexico. I'm wow. this is amazing. Thank you very much for the work you just did, and I'm eager to see it and to take you to Mexico. I would love to.
Thank you.
Really, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Now we'd like to bring up the next team, led by...